So let us start by considering a nuclear reaction in which a nucleus X combines with another nucleus A and they form another pair of nuclei Y and B. We can think of this reaction as a two-step process. First, we have nuclei X and A that come together and combine to form a compound excited system. This compound excited nucleus either after some finite amount of time or instantaneously decays to a nucleus Y by emitting a particle B. In typical fusion reactions, this B can be a photon or a light particle, for instance, a proton, a neutron, or an alpha nucleus. A very common notation for this reaction, X and A goes to Y and B, is this one here, in which the heavier or target nucleus X is outside the parenthesis on the left, and then inside the bracket we have the small particle A that hits the nucleus X on the left, and the small particle that is emitted when the reaction takes place on the right. Finally, outside the bracket on the right hand side, we put the new heavy nucleus created via this reaction. So here is an example. This is a reaction in which a proton is captured by an oxygen nucleus. This creates a nitrogen 15 nucleus and an alpha particle. This particular reaction is endothermic, so it requires energy to take place. We'll explain this in more detail in a minute. The nitrogen 15 that is created in this process can then capture another alpha particle, creating a fluorine 19. This process emits a photon, because the input channel of this reaction is the same with the exit channel of the previous reaction, we can stack the two together in this notation. Now, let's have a look at some conservation laws. One quantity that is conserved is the charge. The total charge on the left side is equal to the total charge to the right side. A practical benefit of that is that in our discussion, we can replace nuclear masses with atomic masses. Atomic masses are much easier to measure in the lab. Another quantity that is conserved is the number of nucleons. That is the number of protons and neutrons, or the sum of mass numbers on the left must be equal to the number of nucleons to the right. Last but not least, energy has to be conserved during nuclear reactions. In other words, the sum of kinetic and rest mass energies on the left side must be equal to the sum of the kinetic and rest mass energies on the right hand side. A rest mass energy can be converted to kinetic energy or electromagnetic energy and vice versa, but the sum of the two must be conserved. Now, during a nuclear reaction, energy can either be liberated or consumed. Usually, we call the difference in rest mass energies the Q value of the reaction. If the Q value is negative, then the reaction has consumed energy, or equivalently, the rest mass energy has increased. We call such a reaction an endothermic reaction. If, on the other hand, the Q value is positive, then the reaction is exothermic. It liberates energy. So here is an example of an exothermic reaction that takes place in stars that are more massive than about 10 solar masses. In this reaction, two carbon nuclei combine to form a sodium 23 nucleus and a proton. The reaction liberates 2.23 MeV of energy, and therefore it is an exothermic reaction. Sometimes the combination of two carbon nuclei give a magnesium 23 nucleus and a neutron instead. This reaction consumes 2.6 MeV of energy, and therefore it is an endothermic reaction. The concept of endothermic and exothermic reactions is not new. So chemical reactions release or absorb energy as well. However, in chemical reactions, the transformed energy is of order of a few electron volts, whereas here, a single reaction can liberate or absorb more than a million times more energy. The huge amount of energy liberated during nuclear fusion plays a critical role in stellar evolution, as it replenishes the energy radiated away from the surface of the stars. However, what is more important for astrophysics is the rate at which this energy is liberated. We'll examine the concept of nuclear rates more closely in the next video.